Chapter 11. Factions. Didn't know anyone would willingly walk into this place. Not unless they were looking for trouble. Gone. Every pony in Manhattan is just gone. I was talking with my best friend, Silver Spoon, over terminal chat, when the connection went dead. My best friend is dead. Only she's not lying dead anywhere. 1 minute she was talking to me, telling me about the concert she went to last night at Hoofbeats, and then she was just gone. Erased. They say the ponies in a few of the ministry's buildings might have survived, but that doesn't sound real. Shattered Hoof is more than 2 days' trot from Manhattan, and some of the guards say they could hear the mega spell go off. It was unnatural, alien, not like a real sound. A few of the guards ventured up to the highest bridge, and they came back, describing a huge pillar of perverted green fire with a strange rainbow screen, wrapped with rings of smoke, lifting up into the clouds from just over the horizon where Manhattan was supposed to be. Now they're saying Cloudsdale was hit too, and that Equestria's own mega spells have already been cast back at the zebras. Oh no. Will the zebras hit Ponyville? It's so small. They wouldn't, would they? I've got to warn Mom and Dad. Maybe they can get into Sweet Apple, the stable at Sweet Apple Acres. Oh, please. Oh, please. It's got to still be open. Last week, Silver Spoon told me that stable tech was filing ponies into the stables around Manhattan. But that was only as some sort of test run. Nothing for ponies to panic about. It's not like they knew. I turned off the log. While it was playing, several others had been downloaded into my pipbook. I'd been finding bits of the pony's audio diary scattered around the guardhouse. I had pulled an ear bloom from my armored utility barding and turned it into my pipbook, allowing me to listen to the recording in one ear without giving away my position. Calamity returned from scouting ahead, signaling with his tail that the path was all clear. Movement throughout Scattered Hoof was proving swifter than I thought, and I felt we had any right to expect. Our progress was partially due to keeping our hoof prints as small as possible, no lining our saddlebags with items that could be missed. I made an exception for the contents of the lost and found safe, justifying the theft with the reminder that the safe had not been opened since before the mega spells. So, no pony here would be suspicious if it was empty, so long as I closed and locked it again. But more than that, these ponies didn't seem to consider that the fortress could be infiltrated. They weren't on guard. I'm not a mistress of shadow, but I hardly needed the advanced tutelage from zebra infiltration tactics to slip past ponies who were being oblivious. I'd skimmed through the book while Calamity was fetching the mattress cover. Calamity wasn't quite as good and had nearly tripped a shattered hoof raider to his presence twice now, but we'd managed to hide each time. I figured once we got back to the train fork of Gaud, I'd pass him zebra infiltration tactics to pursue him. It's not as if the book can only be read once, after all. The inside of Shattered Hoof, proper, was a cold, monstrous gray, such like the maintenance of Stable 2, except here all the walls were cracked and chipped, the ceiling decayed, and the lights weak and uneven. Cast from small lanterns hung from railroad spikes chiseled into the wall. The darkening sky of clouds outside turned the high-set, barred windows into dead eyes staring vacantly into the halls. Somewhere down the hall, a terribly sad song was playing over the radio, We were within the range of DJ Pwn 3's broadcast again. Ponies on the expressway, with no features, with no faces. Ponies milling about me, trudging off to nameless places. The song pulled a melancholy chord in my heart. The singer somehow managed to make the Equestria of before the war seem as dreary and bleak as the wasteland itself. As I followed Calamity, I considered turning on one of my other entries from the audio diary, just to drown it out. But I realized that without it playing, with it playing in only one ear, the two would likely mix into something even more depressing. Waiting foals for their birthdays. Have a party. Please be happy. Growing up all too swiftly, losing hopes of what they might be. Well, crap! I muttered, drowsily, as I hugged a shadow behind a placard. Hard work is happy work, and stared across the open rows of desks to the well-lit room beyond. Inside, a pony matching Godwood's description of dead eyes was sitting behind a desk, reading a book. Applied gemstones. He was flanked by at least one guard pony that I could see, and possibly others I could not. And the safe was directly behind him. There was no way to get at it stealthily. Even if I used this stealth buck, he'd hear the safe opening less than a hoof foot away from him. Time for our backup plan, I whispered to Calamity. Got one? Calamity's eyebrows raised. Yeah, load of them. Load them all up in the caboose and kick it free. I winced as he reminded me how well that one had gone. Could be worse, he whispered with a smile. I'm sure Velva's plan would be to go up and ask him nicely. I closed my eyes. Damn it. We couldn't just sit here, waiting for the bastard to move. The longer we hung around, the better chance of getting caught. Okay, I said finally. We'll do that. Calamity's eyes went wide. I was joking, he hissed. Thankfully, to the hot mare silhouette, statuette for returning to some of my telekinetic magic, I carefully levitated my sniper rifle and assault carbine to Calamity. Take these. Go back and hide in that side room with all the old flashlights, I instructed, recalling a room that looked like it hadn't been used for anything other than a few quickies for several months. I'll go and say hello. And when they all shoot at you, then what's the plan? I'm winging it back here. But if all else fails, I have the stealth buck. That should get me out. If shooting starts, don't wait for me. Get safely back to Remedy. With an afterthought, please. Calamity scowled and moved off, muttering something under his breath about the wisdom of winging it to non-Pegasus ponies. I started up another audio log, listening while I gave Calamity time to position himself safely away. The voice of the same mare leapt through my ear bloom, sounding panicked. The communication web is down. I tried and tried to reach Mom and Dad, but I couldn't get through. At first, it seemed the web was flooded, and my calls kept getting bounced. Then it just died completely. We can't reach any of the Ministry of Morale, either. No pony was expecting the one in Manhattan to respond, but not even Canterlot? Could the zebras have possibly destroyed Canterlot? Could they? What happened to Princess Luna? Having heard of the Canterlot ruins, I knew the answer. I toggled to the next log. It's starting to rain outside. It was bright and sunny less than an hour ago. I think the Pegasus ponies are mourning Clouddale. Most of the guards are gone now. They have left me the codes to open the cells. Scoops said it was up to me. No pony else was going to risk setting our guests free. Why me? I'm not the one who's supposed to be in charge. If I don't, these ponies will starve to death in here. But if I do, some of them are really bad ponies. Some even confessed to helping the zebras at Shattered Hoof Ridge when they tried to assassinate Princess Celestia. If I let them go, who knows what harm they might do? What is worse, letting them die here, or inflicting them on a wounded, suffering Equestria? No, no, no. I'm just an inspector. I'm not supposed to make these kind of decisions. Mom? Dad? Silver Spoon? What should I do? I wasn't sure why I was listening to these logs now. Curiosity? Or, in a way, I was paying my respects to the past by listening? By learning? Either way, it didn't matter. Time to go. How'd you get in here? Deadeye scowled, staring down at me. I had 3 magical energy weapons pointed at my head, although the big, brutish pony to Deadeye's left looks like he'd rather kill me with his teeth. Damn it, think. Watcher might call honesty a virtue, but sometimes the ability to light your tail off is a virtue too. Used magic. I am a unicorn after all. I felt a rush of relief. That sounded plausible. Even I might have bought it if I really didn't know that my spells sucked. Better question is, why? Why? Why I came in here? No. Why are fillies different than colts? The slickery pony's voice dropped with sarcasm. What do you think? Stammering, I realized I should have thought my approach through a lot better. I wanted to... I glanced away, mentally searching for inspiration. My eyes fell on a framed news article, yellow with age, which featured a faded picture of a pretty unicorn. Sweetie Belle performs patriotism concert at Shattered Hoof. My eyes snapped back to meet Deadeye's own. To join your crew. You're all escaped slaves, right? Well, I just escaped from Old Appaloosa. I realized, just after I said it, that I was wearing armored stable-barding, and probably looking nothing like an escaped slave. Deadeye was regarding me with a deep, well-deserved suspicion. If they started shooting, I was probably dead. Small and fast is helpful against large, long-range gunfire, but it's no match against point-blank shots from weapons that'll melt you into a puddle. Worse, my heart sank when I realized that Calamity would almost certainly share my fate. From what I knew of my new friend, running and hiding weren't his normal book of tactics. No matter what I told him to do, I suspected he'd choose to join in the firefight. Tell you what, Philly, Deadeye seemed to finally decide, fixing me with a glare. Let's see how you do with a couple of errands. Show yourself to be useful, and we'll chat again. I gulped. Well, at least he doesn't shoot me yet. What do you need me to do? I have a letter that needs to be delivered. Not far, just to Yellow Hill Ridge. Maybe an hour's trot. I've got a map you can download in your pipbuck. Deliver it, come right back, and we'll talk again. As he pushed the sealed envelope across his desk to me, I wondered if it said something like, "Kill the pony carrying this letter." Oh, and you'll need this leg band. It will let Gaudia know that you're okay to pass through. Who? I asked as I slipped on the leg band, feigning ignorance. The bitch of a griffin who runs our welcoming committee. Honestly, she's more trouble than she's worth. But the boss seems to like her, so she stays. For now. The boss? I thought you were the boss. Deadeye's, clearly not having the patience for questions like Gawa did. Scramble. If she talks again, start pulling off her legs. The grin on the brute to Deadeye's left widened. I quickly left, and wordlessly. I hadn't gotten far before one of Deadeye's guards came trotting out after me. He motioned for another, seemingly random, shattered-tooth pony to flank me on the other side. Without words, it was clear they were making sure I found my way out. As we approached the small room where Calamity was hiding, I blurted out as loudly as I could without sounding suspicious. So, escorting ponies out? Is that your official job? Are you the escorter outer? Shut up, Deadeye's guard said warningly. The other replied easily. Actually, no. I'm just a rockbreaker. I raised an eyebrow. A rockbreaker? So, what's your story? He seemed amiable enough. Slavers assaulted my family's homestead. My brother and I fought back, while my wife tried to hide her foals. They killed my brother, and took my lovely sugar plum and the foals, and left me for dead. As he spoke, a cloud passed over his face. His eyes narrowed, and a tone of sadness tinged with seething contempt into each word. I crawled myself here for the protection. I'm not a raider. I don't do any of that shit. Just work with the rocks, and thank the goddesses that I'm not alone out in the wastes. I nodded solemnly. What else could I do? In the heavy quiet that followed, I could hear the radio in some nearby room. The music stopped, and DJ Pwn 3 was reporting the news. Been warning every pony for some time now to steer clear of Appaloosa. Well, it seems the stable dweller either didn't get the message or chose to ignore it. I've gotten confirmed reports that the little gal marched into Appaloosa and brought her hell on her hooves. Freed over a dozen slaves, many of them foals. I'm happy to report that they're all safe and sound, but there's a bitter tone to this song. When a small army of slavers tried to take their captives back, our heroine of the wastes sacrificed herself, making sure every pony got away safe. So the next song goes out to you, stable dweller. May Celestia and Luna wrap you in their tails. I stumbled, missing a step. My mind shook by rapid realization. The radio was about me again. The poor ponies I helped to freedom had made it safely. I was dead. Well, according to the radio, some pony must have assumed that I had died in the train crash. Either that, or some pony who knew better lied. I wanted to stop, go back, and hear the rest. To kick or shout at the radio, to somehow make her repeat everything from the beginning. Keep moving, Deadeye's guard barked as I fell momentarily behind. I tried it faster, to put myself back between them. Looking at the guard, I asked him this time, what's your story? With a glare, I won my place here in the annual Stomp an Annoying Unicorn to Death competition. Back to being quiet it was then. We were taking a slightly different, more direct path to the yard than the one Calamity and I was used to. The hall we were passing now had several doorways leading to a combination of amphitheaters and mess halls. There was an old stage in the back with tattered and befouled curtains that I imagined Sweetie Belle, the mare who would become Stable 2's first overmare, performed on. The room was crowded haphazardly with tables and benches and several dozen raider ponies scarfing a pale stew, the odor of which was mixing unpleasantly with the stench of unbathed ponies and an underscent of dry rot. I kicked into the next log of my pit buck to distract me. I wasn't fast enough. I should have known better. No wonder the rest of the staff fled so quickly. I should have known that Shattered Hoof would go into lockdown as soon as the mainframe realized we were cut off from the outside. Assisted jailbreak prevention protocols. By the time I made my decision and released the guests from their cells, we were already all trapped inside. I now know how the weaker ones fare. I can only imagine what they will do to me when they find out I'm a member of the staff and got locked in with them. I took the food from the guardhouse fridge and locked myself into this bathroom. I locked several other doors, too. With luck, they'll think that's normal for this door to be locked as well. Because if they really try to break it down, I'm sure they can. I've got maybe 3 days of food, plenty of water, a little bit of medicine. I really hope it'll last me long enough for them to find a way out of Shattered Hoof. My only chance is that they leave before they realize I'm in here. As we exited into the yard, the guard turned on me, pausing or pushing me up against the wall. "You want to know my story?" he growled. "I'll tell you. I was a merchant on a caravan that God's talons were supposed to be guarding. I saw them try and buck us over to slavers, and saw her take them down. So, how'd I got here? She flew me in. Just like we all know she flew you in." My ears tilted. I could feel the stone wall grinding into my backside. "I used to be one of those ponies out there, following God. But you don't become a good merchant if you can't read changes in the market. So I made my allegiance with dead eyes. The merchant turned guard informed me." His voice rumbling with warning. "God's heading for the chopping block, and trust me, you don't want to be standing on the wrong side when the axe comes down." The two of them then turned from me. The other one chuckling. "You go teleport out now." They left me in the rock yard, locking the door behind them. Looking around the yard, I realized that any structure designed to hold ponies prisoner would have the wards to prevent unicorns from just teleporting out. It was a rare magical ability, but one they would anticipate. I moved over to where the mattress cover had been thrown and hid myself, clicking another audio log as I waited for Calamity. The voice was soft, nearly drowned out by the sounds of heating augmented in the background. Out of food. Made what I had stretch, I think. No real way to tell what time it is in here. But I think it's been about a week. At least 4 days. After the food was gone, I raided the garbage can. Some old apple cores. They were brown, mushy, and tasted horrid. The guests outside are doing much worse. There was less than 2 days' food in the pantry when we got into lockdown. Now they're starving. I can hear them outside, arguing about who they're going to eat first. Oh, no, no, no. They can't. It's beyond horrific. The pony's voice was cut off by a muffled scream. The chaos in the background heightened, and I could clearly make out a pony shouting, "Carve her up!" "No! Oh, no, 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 no. Don't make me hear this. Celestia, Luna, please! I can't hear this." Night hugged us in its darkness as Calamity carried me towards Yellow Hill Ridge. Now why are we helping this dead-eyes fella again? Still trying to get a chance at that safe for God. Remember Velvet? "Yep," he said drearily. We flew in silence a few more minutes before... "Where's this place supposed to be again? I can't see a damn thing out here tonight." I had the location marked on my Pitbuck's automap, but I hesitated to lift my leg and look. Shifting myself around while being carried by a Pegasus seemed unwise. Instead, I brought up my eyes forward sparkle to check the compass. Nothing. Either I had forgot to set the compass to keep track of Yellow Hill Ridge, or we were off course. "Dang, damn it! An overshot?" Calamity banked, the cool night wind cutting through my coat and mane. The turn brought a number of flickering lights into view. "Is that what we're looking for? Looks like a whole mess of campers to me." I checked my EFS. Now that I could see the marker, it was pulsating at the very edge of my compass. No, we're still off course. It's back that way. Calamity didn't turn. Hold on a hush. I want to see what this is, then. He swooped a little lower, aiming to fly a pass above the lights. As we neared, I could make out a mass of tents, cookpots, and ponies. As we drew closer, banners, red and black, a stylized white eye with a crimson iris, dominating the center. The ponies down there were armed, and there were a lot of them. I spotted two griffins amongst them, Talon mercenaries, by their armor, but wearing neckbands of red and black, with a distinctive eye. Clearly, not Goblin's Talons. Different company. Towards the back of the camp, I spotted the row of slaver wagons. Calamity beat his wings, grunting softly in pain as he pulled us higher into the darkness. Hopefully, before any of those below had a chance to glance up. Well, ain't this a barrel of bad apples? Calamity, I whispered, not able to unhear that grunt. Your wing. I'm fine. Hush now. We continued to fly. I was now keeping a closer eye on my EFS compass. Yellow Hill Ridge was a quarter mile back toward Shattered Hoof, with just enough hills between us to ensure that we wouldn't have spotted the camp if we come straight to it. This time, I spotted a tiny speck of the waiting courier's lantern. I suggested to Calamity that we fly past, and let me trot up alone, coming from an expected direction. Dias clapped his hooves together, reading me. I mentioned nothing of the Red Eye Slaver Army. Good work, he said finally. Go get yourself some rest. You look like a griffin's play toy. Come back tomorrow. I'll have one more job for you. Do that, and you're in. With that, he waved me off. This time, to my surprise, no pony jumped to escort me. I was only a few yards down the hall when Deadeyes, accompanied by his guards, stumbled walked out of his office, leaving the door open behind him. They turned, moving off in a different direction. I stopped. The safe was unguarded. This was almost too easy. No. It was definitely too easy. I activated the stealth buck. The safe was tricky, but within my range of skill. It popped open with a snap. The only thing inside was the ledger, and I slipped the ledger into my saddlebag. And it just snapped. And it was just snapping the safe shut when Deadeyes and his entourage returned, looking around. If it hadn't been for the spell, they would have seen me. Deadeyes began to trot around the back of his desk from the right, and his brutish bodyguard encircling the left, trapping me. It didn't matter if they couldn't see me. The slightest bump would let them know I was here. As they drew closer, I scrambled up onto the desk itself. The other two guards, one of them ex-merchant, took their positions by the door. I turned on the desk, crouching, and prepared to crawl down and out between them. One of them shut the door. Luna fucked me with the moon. I turned slowly. Deadeyes had stopped and was staring at his safe. Think she took it? The former merchant said, and my heart sank into my stomach. Oh, I think our little spy did whatever Gawandin wanted her to do. Deadeyes smiled. All the better. Let the griffin cook herself. He turned to his guards. Best prepare the others. Red Eye's forces are set to raid Shattered Hoof with sunrise tomorrow. We want to make sure they have no trouble getting in. It's time to meet the big man himself. My mind reeled. Dead Eyes was making deals with the slavers. He was going to let Red Eyes' forces come in and capture the ponies he was supposed to be protecting here. The treachery mirrored the betrayal of Godwood's talons, but on a mucher large scale. Dead Eyes strode behind the desk and clapped his hooves down on it, forcing me to lift one of mine to avoid being touched. I could feel sweat break out across my forehead as I balanced silently. Dead Eyes leaned forward to grab his copy of Apply Gemstones in his teeth. With a fright, I realized I was standing on it. I lifted my forehoof, or my hind hoof, away with just barely enough time. Now, my balance was much more strenuous. My whole body was achy from sleep deprivation, and I searched frantically for a place to put one of my raised hooves before I fell. The door banged open. I toppled onto the floor, and with a thud, as a pair of earth ponies burst in, Dead Eyes jumped back, startled, his book dropping to the floor. "Sir, sorry to interrupt, but we've got an intruder." Dead Eyes stared at the two ponies. "Little unicorn girl, about this high," he said, casually raising a hoof.
"No, sir. This one's a Pegasus.
With the moon." My pit buck alerted me that the invisibility spell was about to wear off. I didn't have a choice. I lurched my hooves and skidded around the ponies, barely slipping between them, then dashed out through the open door. I galloped to the meeting spot as fast as my weird legs could take me. Calamity was waiting for me, hidden under the mattress cover.
"No need for that now, they've spotted you. Got the ledger. Let's go."
We were airborne in moments, and I could tell how tired Calamity was. We kept dropping in the air. I winced at the workout we were giving his mended wing. "We get back to God, and we sleep. No matter what else, we have to sleep." He hadn't complained, but I couldn't tell him his wing was killing him. I played another audio log. This time, the mare was no longer whispering, and I could still barely hear her over the thunderous racket. "Damn it. They know I'm in here." I woke from my nightmare with such a start that I kicked over the garbage can, and they heard it. "They'll break through the door soon." I could hear one of the ponies on the other side of the bathroom door call out abysmal, profane promises. I don't have to guess what they'll do to me anymore. They want me to know. But I'm not going to let them. Go figure. This crappy little gun is going to save me after all. Use the handle to shatter the mirror. This is going to hurt, but if I do it quickly, it won't hurt for long. There was one audio log left. Junction R7 swam up into view throughout the darkness. Exhausted, Calamity brought us in for a slightly rough landing. Ponies pointed with magical glowing weapons at us from all directions. Godwood stepped forward.
"Welcome back. I was beginning to worry about you two."
She looked over us.
"Got the ledger?"
I nodded, shakily.
"Yes, but before you look at it, I want to look at it. And there's something you should know."
Godwood raised an eyebrow.
"Oh?"
he asked appraisingly.
"Deadeye knows. He pretty much let me steal it.
I overheard him saying something about letting you cook yourself."
Godwood sat back, regarding me.
"Finally, I'm impressed. You didn't have to tell me that."
Then, with a narrow look,
"Why did you?
What's in it for you?"
I swayed on my hooves. "There's more, but I'll only tell you that after my friends and I get some sleep. Here, under the safety of your protection."
God's beak broke out into a grin,
the scar twisting it on one side.
"All right, you've got yourself a bargain,"
pointedly. "But while you sleep, I want the ledger."
I nodded. What I want out of it won't take long.
Gal guided us back towards one of the cattle cars. As I stepped a hoof inside, I felt a rush of relief to see Velvet Remedy curled on a bed of slightly moldy hay. She was talking softly with another pony while she watched over a third, whose hind leg was wrapped in what had been some sort of precious remaining bandages. I wondered how many medical supplies we had left, if any. Velvet Remedy jumped up to our return, giving us a weak, bright smile. What did you two do? Take the scenic route?
Yep,
something like that, Calamity responded. And what did I say about this wing? Velvet Remedy pushed Calamity towards the center of the train car that had clearly become her impromptu clinic. Let me take a look at it and change those bandages. Shaking my head in a combination of adoration and despair, I followed behind her. I was too tired to even appreciate how nice a tail sight she had. Finding a bit of hay that looked filthy but soft, I curled down and levitated out the ledger. Flipping through, I found entries going back many years. The newest ones, I felt, were suspect. Whatever Deadeyes was up to, I rather expected he had doctored the ledger as part of it. But the older entries, fettered as they were, couldn't have been altered without being obvious. At least, not by an earth pony. I found myself wondering what a forged cutie mark would look like. It was easy to find the entry I was looking for. Some of the nearby farmers had begun to put up resistance, armed themselves from that merchant caravan we passed through the last month. One of them took a few shots at the raider pony party I dispatched to the east side. Mr. Topaz doesn't care, just wants to keep the rocks coming. So, I think it's time to remind those rock farmers just why they do as we say. Tomorrow, I'll send some of the boys up to Bell Farm to make an example. I told them to make it real graphic, so the rest of the ponies don't have any room to misinterpret. I slammed the book closed, with more telekinetic force than I thought I had left in me. The ledger went flying across the cattle car and bounced off the far wall. Now I didn't want to sleep. Now I wanted to march back there, stuff little Macintosh down Deadeye's throat, and open fire. Instead, I got up, fetched the ledger, and walked out to have a talk with Gawd. So what now? Gawd looked up from the ledger, gazing at me from across her desk. Now? Now you go to sleep. Tomorrow, we'll chat a bit over breakfast, then you're free to go. By then, all the border patrols and outposts will know that I've said you're free to pass. You did the job. A verbal contract is still a contract. And I don't renegade. God frowned slightly. Too bad, too. We could really use a skilled medic here. I let that sink in. Still not ready, or really what I was looking for. How about you? What about me? I pointed a hoof at the ledger. What do you do now? Gawd huffed, then drew herself up. Mr. Topaz contracted me to protect Shattered Hoof and his ponies from threats. Ain't hard to argue that Deadeyes has become just such a threat. She jabbed the ledger with a talon. I can't ignore this. I knew Deadeyes was up to something shady, but this is beyond pale. A little too much on the nose, part of me thought. Almost like Deadeye's treachery was custom-tailored to get under God's feathers. I told her as much. She laughed, a bitter but still rumored laugh. Think I don't see that? I could guess what she might be planning, and another question surfaced in my brain.
What would you do with this place if you were in charge? She gave me a look. Shattered hoof, I mean. What would you do? Slowly, evenly, she intoned. I'm not in charge. I'm not going to be. Even with Deadeyes gone, Mr. Topaz runs this joint. And I'm still contracted with 2M. Right. I thought, as I nodded. But what if you weren't? Velvet Remedy approached me as I returned to the cattle car. I was so tired, but my heart still fluttered a little at her approach. So, is the Griffin actually letting us go? I nodded. Velvet Remedy looked surprised, more than relieved. We get to spend the night. We need sleep. I would insist. Calamity's done more damage to his wing with all that flying around. He needs time to heal. I winced, painfully. Velvet Remedy switched topics, with what my sleep-deprived mind insisted was jarring abruptness. Little Pip, I had the most interesting conversation while you and Calamity were out stealing. I sighed weakly. I wasn't really up for this. See that buck over there? She asked, pointing a hoof towards the dark shape that I presumed was a sleeping pony. His name is Preacher. I nodded, vaguely recalling Gawad saying something about a preacher. He says he came here to spread the word of the goddess out from under the hoof of Red Eye. My eyes perked up. Velvet Remedy had my full attention. The word of the goddess? I asked. The way she spoke made it clear that she wasn't talking about Princess Celestia or Luna. Velvet Remedy nodded. He claims this goddess of his has been speaking with him in his dreams since he was a tiny colt. Her tone suggested her prognosis didn't involve the divine. I wasn't really ready to dismiss it so quickly. Looking sternly to Velvet Remedy, I whispered back. He might be right. Her eyes widened in disbelief, but before she could open her muzzle to mock, I elaborated. Ever wonder how the slavers got ahead of our train like that? I've been wondering if there might be some sort of telepathic magic somehow involved. I felt a sudden urge to travel to Ten Pony Tower and talk to DJ Poem 3. He seemed to have an incredibly good, if imperfect, network of informants. Or possibly some sort of magic or technology that was giving him a lay of the land. I wanted to trade information, find out what he knew. There was a puzzle here, and I still had several pieces short of seeing the picture. If any pony had these pieces, it would be DJ Pwn 3. Velvet Remedy seemed to be digesting my comment. Finally, she spoke. Well, if that's true, it puts the rest of what Preacher said in a more ominous light. She led me to a far corner of the cattle car, whispering, according to Preacher, the goddess chooses to speak to very few ponies. I found myself questioning that. Chooses? Or are there limitations to this so-called goddess's power? And the pony Red Eye is the one she speaks to the most. However, Preacher isn't so sure Red Eye is. Velvet Remedy paused, searching for words. Getting the Melches right. He seems to think that Red Eye's reception is being garbled. Clearly, Velvet Remedy wasn't satisfied with the analogy. But I got the idea. Either way, Velvet continued. Either that, or he's just not listening. Either way, Preacher is here to spread the word, or the true word, of the goddess, away from Red Eye and his band of slavers. I thought of the armed camp, parked a few hours' trot outside of Shattered Hoof territory. Preacher didn't go that far. He didn't go far enough. I hesitated to ask. And what is the true word? I really didn't want to ask Preacher directly. Sure, I'd get an answer that wasn't tainted by Velvet Remedy's own prejudices, but at the cost of being roped into sermon. I was too tired to even contemplate that tonight. Praise me, worship me, and I will lift you up, and you will become one, united under me. Velvet Remedy had clearly suffered through hours of this, and I could understand why Gawad had been wary of gaining another preacher. I nodded to Velvet. There's a pile of hay calling my name. We're going to talk to Gawad again at breakfast tomorrow, but after that, we're free to go. I wasn't so sure, however, that I wanted to leave just yet. I played the last audio log before I headed to bed. This time, the banging on the bathroom door was much louder, rhythmic. It sounded like the ponies outside were using a piece of furniture as a battering ram. I could hear structural cracking from the doorframe. The mare's voice was weak, and she spoke in a disturbing song. I hear you knocking, but you can't come in. I hear you. Yeah, I hear you. Wow. I just realized, I've got all these diaries, and the only ponies that will hear them are you fuckers. Fuck you all. Every last one of you. My. Oh, wow. Ditzy. What was I? You know? I kind of think red is my color. Splash, splash, clop, clop. Hey, Silver Spoon. Let's paint the town red. Or, you know, at least the bathroom. Oh, keep knocking, you bastards. Doesn't go with my cutie mark, though. That's okay. It's a stupid cutie mark anyway. Really? A crown of diamonds? What the fuck's it supposed to be, anyway? I mean, I get the diamonds. Celestia knows I've inspected enough of them. Sent the best ones below for years now. Ha! There's something else you're never gonna get. Just like you're not going to get me. My name is Diamond Tiara, and you fuckers didn't get me. I got away. I mean, really though, a crown? What was that supposed to mean? You can't get me. You can't get Footnote. Level up. New perk. Silent Gallop. You have mastered silent movement, allowing you to move quickly and remain silent. You can sneak at full speed with no penalties.